Ashley Brock, reading Nora Roberts' book, Rising Tides, Chapter 10. The following day, as sunset approached, Grace wasn't certain she was glad at all. Her nerves were stretched so tight she could feel them straining and bubbling under her skin. Her stomach continually jumped in quick, like rabbit hops, and her head was beginning to throb in a sharp, intense rhythm. It would be just perfect, she thought in disgust, if Anna managed to get Ethan over here. She simply pitched forward, ill and babbling, at his feet. That would be seductive. She should never have agreed to this foolishness, she told herself. She paced through her little house, yet again. Anna had thought so quickly, made up her mind so fast, with everything in motion so smoothly, that she'd been swept along before she could calculate the pitfalls. What in the world would she say to him if he came? Which he probably wouldn't. She thought, caught between relief and despair. He probably wouldn't even come, and then she'd have sent her baby away for the night for nothing. It was too quiet. There was nothing but the early evening breeze rustling through the trees for company. Aubrey had been there. Where she belonged, they'd have been reading her bedtime story now. She would have been all scrubbed and powdered and curled up on Grace's arm in the rocker, snuggling and sleeping. When she heard her own sigh, Grace pressed her lips tightly together and marched to the small stereo system on the yellow pine shelves in the living room. She liked the CDs from her collection, an indulgence that she refused to feel guilty over, and let the house fill with the weeping and romantic notes of Mozart. She walked to the window to watch the sun drop lower in the sky. The light was going soft, slipping away shade by shade. In the ornamental plum that graced the cutter's front yard, a lone whippoorwill began to sing to the twilight. She wished she could laugh at herself, silly Grace Monroe, standing by the window in her pink dress, waiting for a star to wish on. But she lowered her forehead to the glass, closed her eyes, reminded herself that she was too old for wishes. Anna thought she would have done very well in the espionage game. She had kept her plans locked tight behind closed lips, no matter how desperately she wanted to spill out everything to Cam. She had to remind herself that he was, after all, a man, and he was Ethan's brother, which was another strike against him. This was a woman thing. She thought she was very subtle about keeping her eyes on Ethan all as well. He wasn't going to escape somewhere directly after dinner, as was his habit, nor would he have a clue that his sister-in-law was keeping him on a short rein. The ice cream idea had been a brainstorm. She picked up a gallon on the way home, and knew how all three of her men, as she liked to think of them, sat on the back porch donning bowling bowls of Rocky Road. Timing and execution, she told herself, and rubbed her hands together before she stepped out on the porch. It's going to be a warm night. It's hard to believe it's nearly July already. She wandered to the porch rail to lean over and scan her flower beds coming right along, she thought with a sense of righteous satisfaction. I thought we could have a backyard picnic on the 4th. They have fireworks on the waterfront, Ethan put in, every year, half hour after sunset. You can see them from right here on the porch.
Really? That would be perfect. Wouldn't it be fun, Seth? You could have your friends over and we'll cook burgers and dogs.
That'd be cool. He was already down to scrapping his bowl and calculating how to finesse seconds. Have to dig out the horseshoes, Kim decided. Do we still have them, Ethan? Yeah, they're around.
In music, Anna shifted just enough to rub her husband's knee. The three of you could play. You don't play together nearly often enough to suit me. I'll have to make a list. You'll have to tell me who we can invite in the food. Food! She thought she faced flustered irritation very well as she pushed away from the porch rail. How could I have forgotten? I promised Grace to trade her my recipe for tortilla for hers for fried chicken. She dashed inside her cheek the index card that she neatly written the recipe on, something she'd never done before in her life, then dashed back out again. All politics. Ethan, would you run this over to her? He stared at the little white card. If he hadn't been sitting down, his hands would have jumped in his pocket. What?
I promised I'd give her this today, and I completely slipped my mind. I'd have run it over myself, but I still have a report to finish. I'm just dying to try out that fried chicken. She went on quickly, pushing the recipe card in his hand, then all but dragged him to his feet.
It's kind of late.
Oh, it's not even 9 o'clock.
Don't give him time to think, she warned herself. Don't give him a chance to pick out the flaws. She pulled him into the house, used smiles and fluttering lashes to move along.
I really appreciate it. I'm so scatterbrained these days. Feel like I'm chasing mud to own tail half the time. Tell her I'm sorry I didn't get it to her sooner, and be sure to let me know how it turns out once she's tried it. Thanks so much, Ethan, she added, raising up, giving him a quick affectionate peck on the cheek. I love having brothers.
Whoa, he was baffled, close, little miserable, but the way she said that, the way she smiled when she did, left him helpless. I'll be right back.
I don't think so. That was wisely controlled, chuckle, as she cheerfully waved him off. Second his truck was out of sight, she dusted her palms together, mission clear.
Just what the hell was that?
Can't demand to make her jump? Was surprised. I don't know what you mean. She would have sailed past him and into the house, but he stepped out, blocked her path.
Oh, yeah, you know what I mean.
Intrigued, he angled his head. She was trying to look innocent, he decided, but couldn't pull it off. Too much fear glee in her eyes.
Exchanging recipes, Anna.
So what? She looked at her. I'm a very good cook.
No argument there, but you're not the recipe emergency type, and if you'd been so hell-bent on giving one to Grace, you'd have picked up the phone, which is something you didn't give Ethan a chance to point out, since you were just batting your lashes at him and cooing like some empty-headed twit.
Twit?
Which you're not.
He continued slowly, backing her up since she was trapped against the porch rail.
At all. Shrewd, savory, sharp.
He laid his hands on either side of her hips to gauge her.
That's what you are.
It was, she supposed, a fine compliment. Thank you, Cameron. Now, really, you should get to that report.
Why'd you call Nathan and then going over Grace's?
She shook back her hair and a bland look dead into his eyes. I think a shrewd, savory, sharp guy like you ought to be able to figure that out.
His bros together. You're trying to get something going between them.
Something is going between them, but your brother is slower than a lame turtle.
He's slower than a lame turtle with bifocals, but that's Ethan. Don't you think they should muddle through this on their own?
All they need is 5 minutes alone, and that's all I did. Work it out so they have 5 minutes alone. Besides, she slipped her arms up and around his neck. We deliriously happy women want everyone else to be deliriously happy, too.
He cocked his brow. Do you think I'm going to fall for that?
She smiled and leaned up to nibble his bottom lip. Yeah.
You're right.
He murmured and let her convince him.
Ethan sat in his truck for a full 5 minutes. Recipes. That's the dumbest damn thing he'd ever heard of. He'd always thought Anna was a sensible woman, but here she was, sending him off to deliver recipes for Christ's sake, and he wasn't ready to see Grace just yet. Not that his mind was made up about her, but even a rational man had certain weaknesses. Still, he didn't see how he was going to get out of it. As he was already here, he'd make it quick. She was probably putting the baby to bed, so he'd just get it done and get out of her way. Like a man condemned, he dragged himself out of the truck to her front door. Through the screen, he could see the flickering lights of candles. He shifted his feet. I noticed that music was playing. Something with weeping strings and soaring piano. He never felt more ridiculous in his life than he did standing there on Grace's front porch holding a recipe for a pasta dish while music slid around the warm summer night. He knocked on the wood frame, not too loudly, as he worried about waking Aubrey. He gave serious thought to sticking the card in the door and hightailing it, but he knew that would be cowardice, plain and simple. And Anna would want to know why he hadn't brought her the instructions for Grace's fried chicken. When he saw her, he wished the God Almighty had taken the coward's way. She walked out from the kitchen at the back of the house. It's a tiny place. It always made Ethan think of a dollhouse, so she didn't have far to travel. To him, it seemed he watched her walk through that music, that light, for hours. She wore pale, fragile pink that skimmed down to her ankles with a row of tiny pearl buttons from the hollow of her throat to the hem that flowed all around her bare feet. He had rarely seen her in a dress, but now he was too thunderstruck by the sight of her to question why she was wearing it. All he could think was she looked like a rose, long and slim, just ready to bloom, his tongue tangled up in his mouth.
Ethan! Her hand trembled lightly as she reached the door, opened the screen. Maybe she hadn't needed to start a wish on after all, for here he was, standing close and watching her. I was.
Her scent, familiar as his own, seemed wrapped around his brain. Anna sent you. She asked me to bring this by.
Mystified Grace took the card he held out. The sight of the recipe, she had to bite the inside of her cheek, came from laughing. Her nerves backed off just enough that her eyes smiled when she lifted them to his. That was nice of her.
You got hers.
Her what?
The one she wants, the chicken thing.
Oh, yes, back in the kitchen. Come on in while I get it. What chicken thing, she wondered, nearly giddy from suppressed laughter that she knew would come out well on the historical site. The casserole, right?
No. She had such tiny waist, he thought. Such narrow feet. Fried.
Oh, that's right. I'm so scatterbrained lately.
He's going around. He mumbled. He thought it was safer to look anywhere but at her. He noticed a pair of fat white candles burning on the counter. You blow a fuse.
Excuse me?
What's wrong with your lights?
Nothing. She could feel the heat rise in her cheeks. She didn't have a recipe for fried chicken written down anywhere. Why would she? She just did the same as you always did when it came time to make it. I like candlelight sometimes. It goes with music. He only grunted, wishing she would hurry up so he could get the hell away.
He already put Aubrey to bed.
She's spending the night with my mother.
His eyes, which had been steadfastly studying her ceiling, shot down and met hers.
She's not here.
No, it's her first overnight. I've already called over there twice. She smiled a little. Her fingers reached up to fiddle with the top button of her dress and away that made Ethan's mouth water.
I know she's only a few miles away and as safe as she'd be in her own crib, but I couldn't help it. The house feels so different with her here.
Dangerous was the word he'd have used. Pretty little dollhouse was suddenly as deadly as a minefield. There wasn't any little girl innocently sleeping in the next room. They were alone with music sobbing and candles flickering, and Grace was wearing a pale pink dress that just begged to have those little white boots undone one by one by one. The tips of his fingers began to itch.
I'm glad you stopped by.
Holding tight to her courage, she took a step forward and tried to remember that she had the power.
I was feeling a little blue.
He took a step back, more than his fingertips were itching now. I said I'd be back directly.
You can stay for coffee or whatever.
Coffee? If his system got any more wired than it was at the moment, he would have jumped right through his skin. The Nancy hit hornpipe. I don't think.
Ethan, I can't steer clear of you the way you asked me. St. Chris is too small, and our lives are too tangled up together.
She could feel the pulse in her throat pounding against her skin in a hard instant little knife.
And I don't want to. I don't want to steer clear of you, Ethan.
I said I had my reasons, and he could think of them. What they were if she just stopped looking at him with those big green eyes. I'm just watching out for you, Grace.
I don't need you to watch out for me. We're all grown up. Both of us. We're alone. Both of us. She stepped closer. She could smell his after-work shower on him. But under it, as always, was the scent of the bay. I don't want to be alone tonight.
He edged back. If he hadn't known her better, he'd been have sworn she was stalking him. I've made up my mind on this. But damn it, it wasn't his mind working overtime. It was his loins. Just stay back, Grace.
It seems like I've been standing back forever. I want to move forward, Ethan, whatever that means. I'm tired of staying back or standing still. If you don't want me, I'll live with it. But if you do,
she moved closer, lifting a hand to lay it on his heart and discovered that his heart was pounding.
If you do, then why won't you take me?
He backed hard to the counter. Stop it. You don't know what you're doing here.
Of course I know what I'm doing. She snapped it out, suddenly furious with the pair of them. I'm just not doing a good job of it, since you'd rather climb up my kitchen wall than lay a finger on me. What do you think I'll do? Shatter into a million pieces? I'm a grown woman, Ethan. I've been married. I've had a child. I know what I'm asking you, and I know what I want.
I know you're a grown woman. I've got eyes.
Then use them, and look at me.
How could he do otherwise? Why'd he ever believe he could? They're standing in shadow, and light was everything he yearned for. I'm looking at you, Grace. With my back to the wall, he thought, in my heart, in my throat.
Here's a woman who wants you, Ethan. One who needs you.
I saw his eyes change that. Sharpen, darken, focus, on an unsteady breath.
She sat back. Maybe I'm what you want. What you need.
He was afraid she was, and that telling himself he could and would with a do without her had been an exercise in fidelity. She was so lovely, all rose and gold, and the candlelight, her eyes so clear and honest. I know you are, he said only, but that wasn't supposed to change anything.
Do you have to think all the time?
It's getting hard too, he murmured, right at the moment.
Then don't. Let's both stop thinking.
Even as the blood pounded in her brain, she kept her gaze locked on his and lifted her hands, trembling hands, to the top button of her dress. He watched her unfasten it, staggered at how that single, simple gesture, that tiny inch of exposed skin, could electrify him, felt his lungs clog, his blood sizzle, and his needs, all the long-denied needs, begged for release. Stop, Grace, he said gently. Don't do that. Her hands fell back to her sides and feet. She had her eyes. Let me do it. Her eyes blinked open, stared stunned at his sober gaze as he stopped. He stepped to her. She took him one shaky breath and held it. I've always wanted to. He murmured and slipped the next tiny button free.
Oh, the breath she came out in a hitch and saw, Ethan.
You're so pretty. She was already trembling. He lowered his head.
to brush a kiss over her lips and soothe. So soft, I've got rough hands, watching her, he's giving his knuckles down her cheek over her, but I won't hurt you.
I know you won't.
You're shaking. He undid another button, then another.
I can't help it.
I don't mind. Patiently eased the button sprayer with. I guess I knew deep down, if I walked in here tonight, I wouldn't be able to walk away again.
I've been wishing you'd walk in here. I've been wishing it a long time.
So have I. The buttons were so tiny, his fingers so big, her skin, where the dress parted, where the edge of his thumb slid up, was so soft and warm. You tell me if I do something you don't like, or if I don't do something you want.
The sound she made was part moan, part laugh. I'm not going to be able to talk in a minute. I can't get my breath, but I wish you'd kiss me.
I was getting to it. He nibbled gently, teasingly, because he hadn't taken his time the first time. He tasted her. Now he would linger, sample, find a rhythm that suited them both. When her sigh filled his mouth was sweet, he loosened more buttons and let the long, deepening kiss spin out. Touched her nowhere else. Not yet. Only mouth against mouth, with flavors mixed. When she swayed, he lifted his head, looked into her eyes, cloud now, heavy and aware. I want to see you. Slowly, inch by inch, she slipped the dress from her shoulders. They were sun-kissed, strong, gracefully curved. He'd always thought she had the prettiest shoulders, and now he indulged himself by tasting them. The hum in her throat told him she was both surprised and pleased by the attention. He had a great deal more to give her.
She'd never been touched this way, as if she were something rare and precious. What that touch stirred in her so was so new and warm. Her skin seemed to soften and sensitive. Sensitized under the brush of his lips, the blood beneath, to go thick and lazy. She only sighed as her dress slid down to pool at her feet. When he eased back again, she could only stare up at him in wonder. Her lashes fluttered. Her pulse skipped when he stroked his fingers lightly over the swell of her breast, above her simple cotton bra. She had to bite her lip to hold back the groan when he flicked open the hook, when he gently cupped her breast and swung. Do you want me to stop?
Oh, God. Her head fell back, and this time the groan escaped. His working man's thumb,
were skimming slowly, rhythmically over her nipples.
No.
Hold on to me, Grace. He spoke quietly, and when her hands came to his shoulders and grip, he brought his mouth to hers again, drawing more this time, asking more until she went limp. Then he lifted her into his arms. He waited until her eyes opened again. I'm taking you, Grace.
Thank God, Ethan.
He had to smile when she brushed her face into the curve of his shoulder. I'll protect you. For a moment, as he carried her off, she thought of dragons and black knights, and the more practical meaning got to it.
I take the pill. That's right, I haven't been with anybody since Jack.
He'd known that in his heart, but hearing it only added to his steadily rising need. She lighted candles in the bedroom as well, slim tapers there that lanced up out of the tiny white shelves. The white of her iron headboard glowed in the soft light. White daisies sprang out of the clear glass vase on the small table beside the bed. She thought he would lay her down, but instead he sat, cradled her, holding her, chugging her with those slow, endless kisses until her pulse beat thickly, grew sluggishly, his hands began to move. Everywhere he touched, a small fire fanned into flame. Cal's hands slipping, sliding over her skin, long, rough, aged fingers stroking, pressing. There, oh yes, just there. The day-long stubble of beard rubbed the sensitive curve of her breast as his tongue circled, then flicked, and always, always, his mouth coming back to hers for one more, just one more endless, mind-reeling kiss. She tugged at his shirt, hoping to get back some of the pleasure, some of the magic, found the scars and muscles in the man. His torso was lean, his shoulders broad, and flesh warm under her seeking fingers. The breeze whispered through the open window, the call of the whippoorwill chasing after it. The sound no longer seemed so lonely. He eased her back, settled her head on the pillow, then bent to pull off his boots. Pale gold candlelight swayed against shadows, the collar of smoke, both shades shimmering over her. He watched as her hand snuck up to cover her breast, and he paused long enough to take in a kiss and nose. I wish you wouldn't, Hamer. You're such a pleasure to look at.
She hadn't thought she'd feel shy. He knew it was foolish, but she had to order herself to let her hand fall onto the bed. When he slipped out of his jeans, she had to struggle with her breathing all over again. No fairy tale knight had ever been built more magnificently or bore scars more heroically. This desperate with love, she held out her arms in welcome. He slipped into them, careful not to press his full weight onto her. She was fragile, he reminded himself, so slim and so much more innocent than she believed. As the rising moon slanted its first light through the window, began to show her signs and sighs and murmurs, long, slow caresses, quiet sips and tastes. His hands were roused, devastated.
Devastated, but never hurried, hers explored, admired, and forgot to hesitate, found where she was most sensitive, the underside of her breast, the back of her knee, the sweet, shallow, seductive valley between her thigh and her center. So focused on her was he that his own rising knee took him by surprise, flashing once, hard and strong, dragging out his moan when he took her breast into his mouth. She arched, shuddering at the edgier demand, and the rhythm changed, with his breath growing ragged. He lifted his head, his eyes intent on her face, his hands slid between her thighs, pressed there against the heat, found hard way. I want to see you go over. He played his finger over her, in her, as her breath quickened. Pleasure, panic, excitement, all raced over her face. He watched her climb, closer, closer, with her breath tearing, then released on a strangled cry as she peaked. She tried to shake her head to clear it, but the delicious dizziness continued to spin. The familiar room revolved, hazed, so that only his face was clear. Was real. She felt drunk and dazed and unspeakably aroused. This was love as she dreamed it would be. Her skin quivered as he slid slowly up her body, his mouth laying warm, damp trail. Please? It wasn't enough. Even this wasn't enough. She craved the mating, the union, the final intimacy. Ethan, she opened an open forearm. Now? His hands cupped her face, his lips covered her lips. Now, he murmured against them and filled her. Their long groaning sighs blended that first endless shudder of pleasure as he buried himself inside her, rocked them both. When they moved together, smoothly, silkenly, as if they'd only been waiting. Desire was fluid, its current steady. They rode it, thrilled to pace, to deep, to resonating pleasure of each long, slow stroke. Grace whirled close to the edge, felt the orgasm build. She slid through her system like velvet ribbon so that she rose up. Farther up, wild in the glow, then floated down into weightless wonder. He pressed his face into her hair, and let himself follow.
He was so quiet it worried her. He held her, but he would have known she'd need him to. Still, he didn't speak, and the longer the silence stretched, the more she feared what he would say when he broke it. So she broke it. Don't tell me you're sorry. I don't think I can stand it if you tell me you were sorry.
I wasn't going to. I promised myself I'd never touch you like this, but I'm not sorry I did.
She rested her head on her shoulder just under his chin. Will you touch me like this again?
Right this minute.
Because she caught the lazy amusement in his eyes, she relaxed and smiled. I know better than rush you on anything. She lifted her head because it was vital that she knew. Will you, Ethan? Will you be with me again?
She raised her finger through her hair. I don't see talking either of us out of it after tonight.
If you started to, I'd have to try to seduce you again.
Yeah? Smile crept over his face. Then maybe I should start talking.
Thrilled, she rolled over him and hugged him hard. I'd be better at it next time, too, because I wouldn't be so damn nervous.
Nerves didn't seem to get in your way. I nearly swallowed my tongue when you walked to the door in that pink dress. He started to nuzzle her hair. Stop. There was a, what were you doing wearing a dress to sit around at home?
I don't know. I just was.
She turned her head and kissed his long throat. Hold on. Knowing just how quickly she could distract him, he took her shoulders and lifted her up. A pretty dress, candlelight. It's almost like you were expecting me to come along.
I'm always hoping you will, she said and tried to kiss him again.
Sending me off with a recipe, for Christ's sake. In a smooth, easy move, he plopped her on her butt beside him and said, you and Anna got your heads together on this, didn't you? Set me up.
What a ridiculous thing to say, she tried to
friend indignant, but could only manage guilty.
I don't know where you get these ideas.
You never could lie, with a spit. Firmly took her chin in one hand, holding it into her eyes, shifted his. It took me a while to figure it out, but I've got it now, don't I?
She was only trying to help. She knew I was upset about the way things were between us. You got a right to be mad, but don't take it out on her. She was only,
did I say I was mad?
You interrupted. No, but, she trailed off. You don't care what. You're not mad?
I'm grateful. His grin was slow and wicked, but maybe you ought to try to seduce me again, just in case. End of chapter 10.